another state. I'm trying to eat down a whole nother plate. Seemed like my homies were stuck in the hood. I just told them be safe in the state.
All right, welcome to the Black Miss Podcast. Welcome to the Black Miss Podcast. Welcome to the Black Miss Podcast. I'm your host, Too Black. I will be joined later on by my co-host, Ryan, and we will be having a guest today. Her name is Dr. Joy James. Dr. Joy James is the Ebenezer Fitch Professor of Humanities at Williams College. She is an editor of several anthologies on politics and incarceration, including The New Abolitionists and Imprisoned Intellectuals, along with a plethora of other great books. That there are too many to name, actually. And she was also the editor of the Angela Y. Davis Reader. If you are a follower of this podcast for at least over a year, you may remember that she was on our show just about a year ago to discuss Black August and in relationship at the time to the myth that we're not our ancestors, which is a terrible phrase that gets plastered across a lot of bad t-shirts. But we're not going to get into that. But it does kind of relate to the subject. So we, you know, again, the myth was Angela Davis. The myth was Angela Davis was a Black Panther. Now, this episode or this series is not meant as a shot at Angela Davis. You know, we just wanted to clarify the actual history and what really went down. And our main critique was a lot of times these aesthetics of Black radicalism, or as I called it in the first episode, Black militant vibes, I just get collapsed into this single category, this amorphous idea of militancy that doesn't explain really any politics or what people stood for. It's just guns and black fists and afros, and it's just a vibe. You know, there's really no articulation of what needs to be done. So we wanted to walk through the timeline to just lay out who Angela Davis was, what she was involved with, and we pretty much walked from, you know, her childhood up to post her trial that she had faced, which kind of brings her into prominence, particularly in the Black community, when she had to go on the run from the FBI and such and such. But we actually talk about the case, and we talk about her relationship to, you know, the revolutionary and political prisoner George Jackson and the Black Panther Party. And the actual facts is that she was not a member of the Black Panther Party, but she did work with the Black Panther Party primarily as a member of the Communist Party. She worked with the Black Panther Party to help organize political education within that party, but she also had strong critiques of the party. She thought they were sexist. She didn't really particularly care for the nationalism. Again, these are her words. It's posted in episode one. But she was not a member of the party, and her critiques of Black Panthers just gets collapsed and lost in the history when you just add it in because she had a fro and you think she was angry. Like, these things are ahistorical and revisionist. They don't really explain anything. So we clarify that history. So coming into this episode, Dr. Joy James actually listens to our episode. Maybe she finishes it about 2 or 3 minutes before she hops on to talk with us. So it's fresh on her mind. So what we end up doing is we just pretty much walk back through that timeline that we laid out in the first episode. But this time we do it from, you know, from her standpoint, and she offers more perspective than we were able to offer because we mainly just stuck to the on the ground facts. But she offers an interpretation and layout that gets us to think about this in a much broader way, and what it means for today and how we understand this idea of Black radicalism, how it gets watered down, how it gets sold back to us, and so on and so forth. So I know some people understand that, you know, Dr. James wrote the piece Airbrushing Revolution, which will be linked in our show notes, that did have some critiques of Angela Davis. And as we said in episode one, Angela Davis is not a god or a perfect person, so it's okay to offer critiques. But I do want to underline once again that this series is not about trying to single out one person and bash them. So we're not doing that to Angela Davis. Anything we say is it within a larger context of trying to understand our history, our struggle, and our liberation. And anyone could get critiqued or anything within that framework, but it's not an aim at one individual person. So without further ado, I'm gonna let it go. I'm gonna get started. All right, thank you.
Let's just stay with your framework. Again, like I was saying, just what's going on, at least in my mind, in the academy, and I don't think y'all take your you know, leads from the academy, but for some of us who are in it, it overly determines our political thinking and also our hesitancy and like when we feel we're about to get burnt. So like the Academy is really serious about who they choose as their representative revolutionaries. And I would say, well, I mean, if it's not George, I don't know who you're talking about, right? But I do know who they're talking about. And so I think they blur the lines, and then they have to protect their investment in personas. Like people don't know the person, unless you know, right. You hung out with them for years, but the persona has a political function. And so, I mean, the way I think of it, if you can have an authentic revolutionary who's an academic, that tells you academics are not compromised. I don't think you can have an authentic revolutionary who's an academic. Mm-hmm. You know, right. I tell you straight up, I'm compromised.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah, I noticed in your interview with Millennials Are Killing Capitalism, you emphasize I'm not a revolutionary. Mm-hmm. I know you kept saying, is that in reference to what you're talking about now as far as academics?
Yeah, and that's also my say, the go-to is I'm a librarian. I mean, like, so... You read that autobiography so closely. It's pretty magnificent the way y'all parsed it. I mean, I like, oh, I forgot that. And I teach that. I don't even remember that part, right? But the larger context is that Davis was raised, you know, when she decided as a young kid not to be a pediatrician and go to Fisk, right? Because mm-hmm, she got right. to everything, right? To that early medical school, like all the way our elite kids, you know, go where they go, up the ladder. But when she decided that she was gonna be more of an academic philosopher, she did not become an activist or a rebel until, as you pointed out, she goes to UC San Diego. Mm-hmm. And there's a surge. It's almost like, I need role models. It's none of it's organic, right?
Right.
She misses the civil rights movement in Birmingham, in part because the Black middle class or Black petty bourgeoisie, and right, having people threaten to firebomb your home, and fortunately her home was never bombed, but other people's homes were. But this is where class also plays in. And I feel conflicted because, you know, based on my being petty bourgeois, it also can easily close some doors in terms of my aligning with rebels and with revolutionary struggle. But the organized parents, and it wasn't just her parents, there were other Black parents who were school teachers, they figured out how their children would get to the Northern schools in New York, New Jersey, and Massachusetts through American Friends Service Committee. I mean, that early integration before the South even agreed to integrate, like before, you know, Ruby and all, you know, the little kids have to have right. broken glass that they're tripped on. And so the violence of integration is not part of their history, even though the trauma and the violence writ large against the community is, because they're not integrating until hostile zones. They're still hostile because they're white liberals, but they're white liberals who want to see themselves as not being white supremacists, not being the Klan, not being Bull O'Connor, not right. being teachers. So they're the ones who want to adopt you. And there were places in the autobiography when she says the fluent white kids from the Little Red Schoolhouse where she ends up going to school, that's in the village. And then later when she goes to the Women's House of Detention, it's right down the street. So there's the irony in the tragedy, right? In the trauma.
Right.
But like, you know, her affluent white friends are like, come over for dinner. And then they call their Black maids out of the kitchen to introduce them to Angela. Like, here, this is like, we're sitting down with it. You can't sit at the table. You need to do the dishes, like, you know, and then go home. But here's a Black girl who's kind of like us, but not like us, but now becomes a trophy. So what happens when a child is turned into a trophy?
Mm-hmm.
Like the symbol of Black progress writ large. Look at what we can do as a people if we integrate, not into white working class, not even into white middle class so much, but into white affluence. And so this for me is part of the fascination of how Davis the teenager becomes a collective project, because they're being parented by multiple people. Once Mrs. Sally Bell Davis decides, and remember, she's getting a graduate degree at NYU. That's how her children are acclimated to the quote freedoms in, you know, air quotes, in New York City. Like Malcolm said, it's up south, but it has benefits, right?
Right.
Benefits. So when Angela protests segregated lunch counters, nobody's going to pour coffee or sugar or knock her off a stool, because it's like after school, little red schoolhouse kids, teenagers, they protest and then they go home because it's up north racism. Like they don't, we're just like, we're not doing spectacles of leaving blood on the concrete or blood on the bar stool. So if you're a Black child among white elites, the notion of your being exceptional and aberrational, they just melt. I don't know if y'all have kids or what you went through in terms of schooling, but even though there were bombings, and there were, once they integrated into a middle-class neighborhood in Birmingham that they labeled Birmingham, the elite status never dissipates. And once you decide to integrate, not just as Black elites among the Black working class, because she's going to the elementary school and the middle school, right? With elementary school kids, you know, right? Middle school kids who don't have a lot of money. And that's why you see an autobiography, because she's very ethical. And as you know, Davis cares.
Yeah, she notes the what the Jan, was it the Janice head or something of that nature, how she felt split. Contradictory. And I know you said you had edited the Angela Davis reader, and that's like the first paragraph in the introduction is about that, the Janice head, and how she felt this split between looking forward and back, and never quite felt in place. And she talks about in the bio how, I think we talked about in an episode, the first episode, how she felt like she didn't want to do a lot of the Black bourgeois things, like the Jack and Jill type stuff. She didn't want to host cocktail parties. So she said she wanted to go up north. But I think you make an interesting point. I really never thought about the integration of just sending your kid up north. Like, I don't think we get that kind of connection. Generally, it's, we think of integration as just forced integration and opening up the market, and as opposed to like Black elites and Black middle class being able to send their children somewhere where it's less, or it's a little more tolerant. I never really thought about it in that way. And then becoming a collective project, like you said.
Yeah, and doesn't it, I mean, she ends up living with white Quakers in Brooklyn Heights. So you're not sending, I mean, everything, every sector that's anti-Black is some form of a war zone.
Right.
But and I understand, I'm not saying if I weren't in that era and a parent, I wouldn't do the same. I mean, look, the four girls who I know, like Cynthia, Adame, I mean, we can name them, right? The ones that are murdered in the church. The children who stay become warriors, but then you have casualty lists. And Davis writes about this later, but you remember the name of Emmett Till. Mm-hmm. But you don't remember the name of Addie Mae. And then remember, like, these are all losses. And what happens when you lose a child? I mean, time is inverted. Your children are supposed to outlive you and bury you. You're burying the child. But these girls were also activists. Yeah. Emmett, you know, Emmett was not. And that's, there's no fault, no shame. But in the out-migration of Black elites, and it was all four Davis children, they went to middle school, high school, maybe it was mostly high school, in New York or New Jersey. And other families that they knew, you know, from Birmingham went to Massachusetts or so forth and so on. So when you get to the Little Red Schoolhouse, it's unique because it's a political formation of affluent Jewish families who got caught in the McCarthy era. So the whole thing of losing your job because you're a communist, it's not aberrational to Angela Davis as a child. Because in the memoir, she says she's 15 when she reads the Communist Manifesto.
Mm-hmm.
But there are probably a lot of kids in your high school reading the Communist Manifesto. That is atypical, whatever region you were in the U.S. So they created a leftist school on expensive real estate. I don't know, you know, I'm sure the West Village is more, you know, what is it, high tone or high class, whatever, than it was back in decades ago.
Right. She describes them as utopian socialists. Yeah.
So here's my perspective on this, right? She is cared for, but she's also an isolate. And I think that's part of this constant searching to fit in, right? Because when you're, you know, the Quakers are nice and they're introducing her to leftist people. Bettina Apthecker, she meets when she's 15, Herbert Apthecker's daughter. Through them, she meets W.B. Du Bois at their house. I mean, it's really high scale leftist integrated society, but it's not your own bedroom or your backyard or the kids off the block you grew up with.
Mm-hmm.
And so at some point, I think the iconic persona is likely crafted or begins to form whether or not she wants it, right, as a shell while she's a sophomore in high school. Because even though, you know, there are family friends who moved to New York City because they were driven out of Alabama because they were Black communists, these are the Burnhams, and Margaret Burnham will be one of her attorneys, right?
Right.
It's not the same thing as the intimacy of the home. And so you're always on show. You're always on spectacle. You have to be impeccable. Okay. You know, that first Black that integrates whatever. And right. Then if you're the first Black integrating white leftist culture, you have to some degree, reflect that culture back to whites so that they see you as belonging.
Mm.
And I think that tracks you straight up to Che Lumumba. And George is the aberration. George, I mean, hooking up with that family, right? George's mother, George's sister, Jonathan, you know, George, I mean, that is what takes Davis from the radical zone, but you're still tethered to structure and employment, into the zone of the revolutionary rebel who is Cage, who Davis is not really in that zone until their weapons that Jonathan has draws them in. And Jonathan didn't just have Angela's weapons. He had her books in his satchel.
Mm.
Theoretical books from Europeans on guerrilla struggle against capitalism and imperialism. I mean, John, that's a 17-year-old intellectual.
Yeah, he's very clear on that in Blood on My Eye. The letters are very clear on the guerrilla warfare part.
We follow, because I love the way that you start, like, origin stories, right?
Mm-hmm.
So the origin story is still tied to class, because also who's the neighbor in that, who's another Black girl in that neighborhood? More close to Angela's younger sister, Fania's age. It's Condoleezza Rice.
Mm, right.
So you know, we can go either way on this. And Condoleezza Rice, just like Fania Davis, also played with the little girls who were murdered as political activists.
Right.
You see, one goes into the Bush administration, you know, false claims of weapons of mass destruction, destabilization of the Middle East. I mean, Afghanistan's a mess, right?
Right.
They lied to him. So why are you POTUS? You can't control your own military. You know, like, it's the carnage is built into the democracy because it's imperial. So right. You have one Black girl who's traumatized, but then her zone is, let me go literally to the far right. Because, I mean, Rice is there behind Kavanaugh when he's being certified, or at least grilled. It's not even a grilling for the Supreme Court. So she gives him that stamp of a Black feminist, you know, conservative right. approval by sitting behind him in the chair, right? And then apologetics for George W. Bush by saying, like, he didn't really abandon Black people and Katrina to die, or suggest like a shoot to kill edict, or, you know, at least, it, you know, didn't oppose it. We'll put it that way.
Right.
So you need a Black military guy honorary to come in and say, but you're not shooting Black people because they need bottled water to stay alive, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we want icons, sometimes, you know, to inspire us, sometimes to sedate us. I think it depends on which Davis is being projected out into the world, whether you're getting inspiration to struggle to the best of our ability despite our fear, or we're getting some kind of sedation that says, if literally my undergrads were telling me this, like last, you know, semester when the election was going on, they were, I'm not on social media, but they're reading these tweets or something like, if Davis will vote for Harris and Biden, who are you to say no?
Yep. Yeah, I went through that. Okay. Yeah, I had whole arguments about that. Yeah, I was on Twitter for that moment. So that one hits. Yeah,
maybe that was you. And so, you know, this is what I've been thinking lately, you know, because like I'm getting older, I'm about, you know, I'm not hopefully transitioning the planet right now, but trying to, you know, transition out of the academy. What happens if our revolutionary struggles are sold back to us? But without any foundation, they become simulacra. They're a brand, right? It becomes a commodity. And so to the extent, and Davis can't completely control her persona. And it's not just because of capitalism. I would say the Communist Party was working that persona too.
Right?
I mean, look
at fascinating. Wow.
Well, look at what we want, or we thought we wanted. We want to be seen as beautiful. Black is beautiful. We want to be not prideful, but have a dignity, right? Mm-hmm. Say it loud, I'm Black and I'm proud. I could go through all those songs in the 1970s, right? I mean, it was, the culture was asserting the value, the beauty, the intellect of Blackness, and Davis embodied all of it. And if it had been Condoleezza, nobody was going to pay attention.
Right.
It wasn't just because nobody was hunting her, it's because she wasn't interesting. She was a reiteration, right? Impression, but like in a like really polished, attractive pearls kind of thing. But look, you're working for George Bush. I mean, what do we have to debate this, right? And then you go to Stanford to, from what I hear, could be wrong. My apologies if I'm wrong, but you're recruited to Stanford and Ivy, even though you don't come from the Ivies, and I wasn't trained in them either, so I don't know how I ended up where I am. But you go to the Ivy because you're going to shrink women's studies and ethnic studies, which are probably the only really politicized programs. So you're coming in as a counter-revolutionary. Or rather, let me say an anti-revolutionary. For me, counter-revolutionary, CIA, FBI. Well, then it gets a little sketchy with Condoleezza because, I mean,
she's State Department.
Yeah, so she was, okay, so, yeah, I
direct ties to the state,
So, I mean, she literally worked for the State Department.
And she, like, you know, how many hundreds of thousands of people, you know. Wow, you destabilize. And we have these, this ongoing war against terror that, when is it over? It's never over. So like a lot of people died because some people wanted to belong to an imperial democracy. Now, if you compare Davis with Rice, and the families knew each other, and Daddy Rice, as Condoleezza calls him, right? He hated Martin Luther King. And he blamed him on the, for the deaths of the girls, right? Which is, you know, I mean, reactionary conservative. I mean, Black people react just like everybody else. When you know, like, I'm not going to fight. And if our kids organize and they get killed, I'm going to blame you because you told them to stand up and resist. And King was a complete pacifist. He didn't tell, he wasn't like Robert Williams, Negroes with guns, right? Which I'm not faulting that either. So what do you do with, if you're Davis and you have all these choices? Most Black kids, definitely not in the 1950s, early 60s, they don't have those kinds of choices. More of our kids have them today. Either they're the lead kids or the scholarship kid, or the kid who's first gen and they have that narrative. And so the boarding school wants you, and it's all white environment because you're going to bring color. And,
right.
You know, and also you're going to be a spectacle even when you don't want to be. So you need a home, you need refuge. And so for a while, like you remember, Davis goes to Brandeis. And why? Well, because it's a Jewish high school. That's where all the kids were going. And it was a completely new university. Like Albert Einstein was on the board until he's like, y'all are, this isn't progressive enough, right? Or they kick him off, right? Because he's too progressive, too radical, right?
Right.
But so you're at Brandeis, you meet Marcuse, but also Malcolm comes. And you write in the memoir, I'm entertained for a minute, but you don't get Malcolm.
Yeah, we actually talked about that. I cut it out in the edit because I was trying to narrow some stuff down. But we didn't touch on it long, but I did find that part interesting, how she she said for a moment she felt happy, and then she felt very uncomfortable. Like she didn't, she liked the undressing, and then she didn't. And she actually writes about this later in life too, in her her Black nationalism piece. She writes about that too. And it's as if she, I don't know, like you said, the relationship to that isn't the same, probably because of the environment that she was in.
Isn't that true of all of us? I mean, think of how many Black academics or Black students are in predominantly white schools that are not like Ole Miss or something, right? They're liberal, and mm-hmm. we want to belong. And it's like, oh my God, you keep talking about white people as the devil. I mean, are they looking at me? Do they think I'm listening to you? Do they think I really, you know, abide by what you just
said?
Right. And so that's not when you bring out like the fact that in elementary school you call white people crackers, right? Because you're trying to tone it down. Because you're like, you're showing that you're poised, you're polished, you're balanced, you can see all sides. And also, if you're coming out of the matrix of the Communist Party, it's multiracial.
Mm-hmm.
So if I understand, it could be wrong, Malcolm's at the mosque right on 127th Street, maybe, I believe around this time, he's in Harlem, but Davis stays downtown. I don't read much in the memoir. Well, Angela Davis is going to Harlem or the Bronx or Bed-Stuy to find Black people. There's no search for Black people. I mean, if they are, they're going to be the Burnhams that are already integrated in the Communist Party. So I could say there are some Black people who raised around white people. As soon as they get a large city, they flee into Blackness. And then that romanticization, I probably mangled that word, that you talked about in your podcast, right? You get off the plane from where? From Germany? not a lot of Black people, right? So you get off the plane. I've been missing people, but you were missing them in Brandeis, and you were missing them in the Little Red School. You've been missing them since you were 15.
Yeah, and she went to France too, right? I think in her senior year or so. So she goes to France. Now she interacts with like Algerian struggle and stuff like mm-hmm. that. And there was a lot of anti-Vietnam protests, Vietnam War, I should say, protests. But and she talks about, I can't remember, I think it was when she was, I cannot remember which country, I think it was when she was in France, it might be Germany, don't quote me on this, but she talks about it in the book, how she hears Stokely Carmichael and Marvin X and several of them speak over there, and she didn't like his take on socialism. And I think this also kind of speaks to the Communist Party ethic, because it's like, she talks about anti-communism in the book, and this would be my kind of critique that I did pull from it. She talks about anti-communism in the book, but she, in a way, she makes it synonymous with the Communist Party, as if there wasn't like other strands of communism. Like the Panthers, many of them were communist. George Jackson was communist, but they didn't rock with the Communist Party. And she seems to like equate like anti-communism with being like critical of the party. I don't know if you noticed that in the book. That was just an observation I had made.
I agree with that take on it. I mean, but look, it's in defense of the party, as you pointed out in the podcast. She's in the party for 22 years.
Mm-hmm.
She only leaves because it's 1991, and the Soviet Union fell. And so she and a group want to bring it, the Communist Party, more into the 21st century. So women's leadership, LGBTQ leadership, and so forth, right? But Gus Hall and the old school, the old guard, are going to squash that. So 200 people leave. But if you read interviews later, Davis says she would have stayed in the party if they had agreed to this diversity, you know,
mm-hmm.
I could say more women, but women were already in the leadership. I mean, when she left, when she was acquitted in 72, June 72, I'm pretty sure she was very close to, or soon after, she was going to be very close to the Central Committee or the leadership. And again, that's rare to be that young, I'm imagining. Because like if you think of like, you know, capitalism, that's the CEO, that's the board of directors, right?
Right.
It's very young at 27 to be asked to sit on the board. But she's an international icon by then. But what I'm suggesting, right? Or are you, I don't care what I'm doing with the verb, but it's really complicated because we didn't make her that.
When you say we, you mean Black people?
Black people, yeah. Like, right. You know, like Black people couldn't save. You want to go down the list? Megger, right. Malcolm, like, why were you able to save Angela Davis? Because white people were invested in that too.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Had the backing and all that. Yeah. Wow.
I mean, if we had pulled this off by ourselves, I would be like, I'll tithe to every whatever. But I'm like, the more I look at it, it's like, wait. And it wasn't, of course, it wasn't just that white people weren't going to be prominent. They were going to be more in the backdrop. But it's still during the Cold War because it's the 1970s. So the Soviet Union, this is the thing I just drew out in Airbrushing, right? Well, when Nixon, who hates black people, like the Haldeman Diaries, like Jews and black people, but black people first, right? It's just like, I hate these people, right? But when Nixon is like, I'm brokering internationalism here. I need to get into China. I need to see what's going on with Soviet Union. These are markets, right?
Right.
But also you need to tamp down the nuclear arms race. So when Nixon says, you can send your atomic physicist or whomever, like your elites, to come sit at the trial and I'll save you some seats. What other black revolutionary ever had an international offer go out like that?
That's a good point.
Well, you think when Geronimo was doing 27 years, like they were like, let's ask the British, or I don't know who they wanted to go, right?
Right.
Indians, like, you know, people from Senegal, would you like us? We'll save 5 seats in the front row. And you can see that we're a democracy. They're telling other Europeans that, who they see as their competitors. And they're also working on their image. Mm-hmm. Like, we're not just telling the Soviets, we're telling the world. We can give fair trials to black militants. It's like, really? Like, mm-hmm. This is really, is that what you do, right? No, of course not. But what they're saying is, in this trial, we can pull out all stops to show you this is a democracy, not a racist, repressive regime. Because if it's the latter, George Jackson is lucid.
Okay. And it's kind of like an international PR campaign.
It's a totally international PR campaign. Uh-huh. Because you have communist parties all over Europe. Americans, are white Americans, like, so funny. The only sector that they defer to as a possible peer uh-huh. are white Europeans.
Yeah. I mean,
that's their lineage.
Makes sense. Yeah.
I mean, right. Like, think about Jackie O'Neill, you know, well, Kennedy, well, she's a Kennedy, going over with President Kennedy and speaking French and stuff like that. Like, this is a performed, like, this bad, I can't say that, but this, like, diminished culture mm-hmm. is a real culture because we have this lineage. I mean, it's a real culture because we're here, indigenous here. Like, all the people who built this country brought culture to it.
Right.
But for the need to be white and supreme, you have to go back to Europe.
Right.
Okay. And so you have to show you're civilized to Europeans. You don't have to show that to people in the Congo.
Right. No. You don't have to show to Indonesia or anything like that. Yeah.
No.
Right.
Yeah. And so they're playing their messaging internationally, and they're trying to counter the Soviets' international message because there is this romantic element to it, right? Like, John Lennon and Yoko Ono write a song in behalf of Angela's freedom, which is kind of cool.
Right.
But Mick Jagger and Keith Richards does one too, and that is not a cool song. It's like Sweet Black Angel, and it's all sexualized, and like George doesn't exist, so there's no male competitor. It's like, I'm gonna rescue my sweet black, and it's like, whoa, like.
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
No, it was too much.
And there's a lot going on.
Davis asked them to write that, but if I recall correctly, they were in Chateau, you know, and it's the Rolling Stones. They have groupies and they get mm-hmm. They write their music. But mm-hmm. there's somebody's chateau that they may or may not have been trashing, but there's a free Angela Davis poster. And so they write this song, The Sweet Black Angel, or something. You can find it online, the lyrics. And I would say they get a little creepy, right? But it's the fantasy projection of rescuing the black damsel in distress who represents this exotic beauty. So there's, you know, the revolutionary like animus to be the hero, mm-hmm. but to save the woman, the desirable woman. And of course, Davis is like, I'm not even paying attention to that, right? That has nothing to do with me. But it doesn't matter if you're paying attention or not. That is what is being projected out into the culture. And when right. you get to the biography, autobiography, and you know that she wrote part of it in Toni Morrison's house in New Jersey. So if okay. Toni Morrison is your editor, you know,
yeah,
it's readable. Like, and also if the, you know, the Communist Party is going to probably take a look at it because you're still in the party before it goes to print. So all the right things are set right. in the right way. So you can appeal to the language of Black people, even though you're kind of raised in white society, like kind of a, you know, German, French, European, you know, if there is a Jewish aesthetic, European aesthetic, whatever, there's still the Black culture, but it's filtered with all these other things. But Toni Morrison always brought it real.
Mm-hmm. Right.
She was just so rooted in, you know, Black culture. And then, you know, The Bluest Eye, Song of Solomon, Sula. I mean, she's also terrifying you at the same time with what she's putting in fiction. So right. Davis partly writes the autobiography there, partly writes it in Cuba as a guest of Fidel Castro. That's it. Mm-hmm. That's the height of the game. You're in mm-hmm. your 20s and you're rolling with Toni Morrison, who's at Random House. And Fidel was like, you want to finish writing it here? Like, we could give you security and a, you know, cabana and whatever. So you're,
yeah.
you have this celebrity in the making with the teenager. And because of the tragedies that just keep accumulating and the hunt that pursues her, as the survivor, she becomes the iconic formation. Look, Davis, in a way, the way I read it, and I could be reading it incorrectly, that becomes our victory. Your colleague says, my grandfather says, I'm a little Angela Davis kind of thing, right?
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah.
Because you stayed alive.
Right.
I mean, because if you can read her autobiography, which is very important, but then you read Soledad Brother that's heavily edited and George just blows you off the page.
Yeah.
and if, even if you read the woman, I'm not going to say her name, right? But when I was teaching at UMass Amherst, I would give her memoir and I'd give Davis, and my white students had more in common in women's studies with Davis than the sister. But the sister had the poetry and the rage and the emotional register. And my students who wanted to rebel went with the sister. I was like, y'all don't even... Do you understand what those politics mean? They didn't even care, right?
Right.
So there's a discipline and decorum, a reticence that appeals to us because we want order.
Mm.
George and John brought disorder for freedom.
Right.
And so you never, when you, if Davis is the embodiment of the revolutionary, you don't have to think about disorder. Because right. the persona is telling you it's going to be orderly.
Right, it's polished, yeah.
It's polished, that's it. And yeah. you can continue to accumulate the 100, you know, most influential people in Time magazine. How does that happen? Time is all capitalism, right?
Right.
Like, yeah, that's a good nobody, point, yeah.
It doesn't, you know, first Obama, who's imperialist, yeah. then Biden, Harris, they're imperialist. But you could, if we want victories that look like the victories that come under capital, then we win with this persona. If we want to struggle with our trauma and face it because people loved us so much, I'm not saying this is the way you should do it, but they died and they fought for us before they died, then you have to grapple with Jonathan. Like mm-hmm. the seven, that's a child, that's not even legal age, right? And yeah. his brother and all these other people. And I don't know if we want to stomach that much pain.
I mean, I had a question about the Captain Maternal, but this kind of speaks to it in a way, because you always talk about that, the stabilizing effect of it, and then you're trying to get free at the same time, and how that's kind of a dialectical process. Do you think that stable, that her image offers more of the stabilizing effect to, and I know there's different phases of it, but I'm just kind of trying to think of a way to dress those together a little bit.
Yeah, I would say, yeah, Davis, Black Lives Matter, they're stabilizers. Mm-hmm. I'm not saying I'm for chaos. I mean, I'm not stupid, right?
Right, right.
But if I know political prisoners, or I read them, or I teach them, I know they're not crazy. Gotcha. Nobody takes those kind of risks unless they thought it through and they also agree to the consequences.
Right. But
for stabilizers, I think they have to mystify or forget some of the violence. Because if you paid attention to it, it'd be like, there's nothing stable here. It's a projection of stability, especially for people who have money and have influential and affluent networks. If you know rich white people who like you, I mean, it's like Derek Bell when he was writing, right? He's brilliant. But he talked about, like, he's caught in the South, they stop his car, and he just says the name of a white judge, and the white cop lets him go without beating him down or taking him to cell. Why? Because it's like having a pass in the antebellum years. You say you belong to a white person.
Yeah, yeah.
A powerful white person. And then it's like, oh, you so-and-so's, you know, thing, right? And then it's like, okay, but next time don't, like, drive on this road, or don't speed, or you weren't even speeding, whatever you were doing, right? It's like, okay, if you're a Black person who belongs to structure, you're protected by structure.
Right.
Because structure doesn't want to keep having to find, even though they keep doing it, new Black people to replace you. So if you're like, if you're doable, workable, it's not like how long does your battery last? Because it is traumatic to be in these structures which are anti-Black. They're just like controlling it.
Yeah.
And so here's where I think it gets complicated. If our leadership is saying that the only way to go forward is through structure, and I'm like, wait, are you being compensated by structure? And if you're being paid by structure, well, I'm being paid by structure, so I don't, you know, again, I'm implicated too, but I never claimed, that's what I say, I'm a librarian. Right. I never claimed to be a leader. I just want to point out the contradictions, because the structure is focused on its stability. So when you stabilize it, every time we tilt it, you're helping it sit upright again. And since it knows how to accumulate, it can accumulate revolutionary Black culture, put it on a t-shirt, put it in a movie,
yeah,
right? Make it into a song, make it into fashion gear, and sell it back to you. So we're buying our own revolutionary struggle as simulacra, because if it's tethered to the rebels, they don't even have to, well, they're mostly gone, transition, right? Prematurely, violently. But if it's tethered to the rebels, you just have to actually pay attention to what they say and what happened to them. And you're like, oh, this is where we live. If it's tethered to, like, aspirational statements and promises, then you can kind of mystify where we live, or you live in a white community that has money. And the police know, like, you belong to your white neighbors to some degree. And so they're not going to, like, roll up and with a battering ram. I mean, so Henry Louis Gates did get arrested, yes. But he was not choked out, which we're grateful for. But the curious thing, or the interesting thing, that he ends up with a beer summit with Biden and Obama and the white cop who arrested him. That's not the norm. Yeah. We don't
end that would never there. Happen in the hood, yeah.
No, no, not even remotely close.
Nope.
So. Do you see the parallel?
Yeah.
Not the norm. Like, when did you ever see that before?
Yeah, like, you kind of answered one of my questions I was about to pose to you. Because Angela Davis talking about her being tied to the structure, which also makes sense why she would say something like Barack Obama being tied to the Black radical tradition, you know. So, because essentially she's maintaining the structure.
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
I was just thinking. I think the part of my problem with that way it gets sold back to us is.
Mm-hmm.
It tells us we can have it both ways.
Yes.
And that's always my issue. And that's just, so the cost that would come with it
is removed from it.
Right.
And you can have it, you can be this revolutionary, at least aesthetically. And you can also have some privilege. And I think now, even more now than even during the time that Angela was, you know, catching this case or whatever, that's being presented to us even more as actual path, is you can have all these kind of, you know, at least radical politics. I don't know if people don't throw around the word revolutionary very often nowadays. They throw around radical at least, and you can have these politics, but mm-hmm. there's no real suffering that has to come with it, other than, you know, maybe right. getting trolled on the internet, or, you know, I mean, even it's like, I mean, to your point about the Henry Louis Gates, even when I hope I'm not stepping out of line, but I've just found it interesting when Alicia Garza got on Twitter and was talking about how she had FBI threats, and the Justice Department came to her door and they told her about it, and that they were they're not FBI threats, but they were death threats. Like, she was warned about this, and you're one of the founders of Black Lives Matter. And I just found that to be interesting. I don't want anything to happen to her. I want to clarify that. I'm just saying, it's just that's not normal either. So if you're really fighting, that's also not normal at all. And now I just found it to be odd. Again, I'm not really criticizing her. Like, I'm more so to your point, Dr. James, talking about that the structure. That's just an odd relationship, you know.
I mean, think of it, right? Like, back to the integration matrix, like from American Friends Service Committee, right? Like, so you can integrate your kids into these white racist schools, not because you want them to be there, right? But like, they stole all the money. So your kids don't have the resources and whatnot. And then the law says, like, you're going to go to this school. And it's like, okay, at least, you know, they'll have textbooks. Uh-huh. And so, you know, people are just screaming the N-word and spitting on you, whatever. That tells you the world is expressing its animus in a physical way, right, of terrorizing you. You integrate into these northern elite schools, and they may like, oh, can I touch your hair?
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh. Or can you, like, whatever. But it doesn't look like a lynching. And so that tells you the world is probably, I mean, it can be dangerous because, you know, people who died, but nobody's trying to kill you in school, and nobody's spitting on you in school. And the teachers are kind or trying to be kind, and you get invited to white people's homes for dinners, whatever. So that tells you what the possibilities are. So I see it like there's a class division here, right? There's a, you know, I mean, again, if you're the scholarship kid who, like, you know, lives in the Bronx or something, and you end up at Yale, then you have a story you can run with for the rest of your life. But then I'm like, okay, so what percentage of that, like 0.0, what percentage of that is what happens with our kids, right? Mm-hmm. If, you know, if hopefully they don't end up in Rikers, but like, what are our choices? Like, you get this rich boarding school, which is 60, 70K or something, and then they want you to be internationalist, so they're going to pay you to go to Europe on spring breaks like everybody else. Or the colleges are like that too. We don't want you to be ashamed. If the rich kids can go skiing in Switzerland, we're going to pay for you to go there too, right? So it's just this weird mind warp because you got in the Golden Gate. But sometimes it's a warped zone. It's like the Wizard of Oz. Like, is this like real land or is this Oz land, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so we're growing up in a you're all grown, but we grew up in a capitalist, uber capitalist, like on steroids society, imperial. That had to have filtered into our consciousness.
Right.
But we throw food away. We waste water, right? So that's structure. Mm-hmm. So Davis just took it to the next level. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
The gorillas who were stuck in the prison, and, you know, as y'all said in your podcast, yeah, it was like the Aryan Nation come to the yard. Nobody's been in the yard for months, maybe almost a year. But if I recall correctly, they were out of the yard because the Aryan Nation knifed two Black brothers to death. Or they murdered somebody. I mean, this is why they had to shut down the yard. But also, at least from some of their reading, it's not just that they shot the three brothers. It's that they said they would shoot the Black men who tried to help the brothers get to the medical center to keep them alive. So it feels like they implicated us in a murder. You have to watch your loved one bleed out and then do nothing, which means, like, in under real law, you would be charged with the crime of just neglect. Like, you should render aid. I mean, the cops are not, you know, to me, your rights, they weren't obligated, but like under ethical law, you don't watch suffering and allow somebody to expire like that.
Right.
But the prison guards act like gods. You know, they take life, they can't bring it back. So in that zone, right, I keep going back to it, it's a war zone. But I think most of the leadership we have now will not use the language of war zone, unless it's like really Afghanistan, right? Mm-hmm. And so right. I'm like, okay, so here's where I get a little like, I can't figure this out with this language. What is a revolutionary struggle without war? And I'm not talking about material war. It could be, you know, psychological warfare, which the state does all the time with us. And the universities and colleges do it because they're ideological factories.
Right.
And anybody, see, I only trust the people, I don't know, maybe many who say this, who would tell you like they don't have the answers. I think a lot of people are saying they have the answers. And I'm like, how could you have an answer? Because one, you're telling me this is not a war zone, right. So that we don't have to prepare ourselves for war or even create a security apparatus, not just physical, but emotional, you know, psychological. You're telling us if we work harder, vote more. And again, I voted for Obama too, that it's going to be okay. Yeah, it's going to be okay for me. I'm petty bourgeois. I mean, the way I suffer is not like somebody at Rikers or in maximum security.
There was a George Jackson quote that goes right to the heart of, I just wanted to read that because it goes to the heart of what you're saying. Get out of blood in my eye. Oh, said if revolution is tied to the dependence of inscrutabilities of, quote, long range politics, end quote, it cannot be made relevant to the person who expects to die tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I think that goes to the heart of what you're saying. That the problems aren't necessarily the same, even if they're coming from a similar source, you know, whether we're talking about white supremacy, capitalism, whatever. But then also, and this is something I had written about, and we've talked about this on the podcast, I think E. Franklin Frazier said it's a long history of saying it, like they don't have the black bourgeoisie or the petty bourgeoisie doesn't necessarily have the political capital to operate by themselves, but yeah. In the same way that the white, you know, petty bourgeois or bourgeois can operate. So they still need the social capital of the black poor and the working class to leverage whatever they want to do.
So
you often see like with George Floyd's, mm-hmm. you know, gets somehow his neck gets stomped on, and that somehow has something to do with somebody getting hired and at Chase. And I just don't,
yeah.
I've been screaming this on every episode we get a chance.
You really have, yeah.
Yeah.
Multiple times.
Yeah.
That's so brilliantly stated. I mean, our deaths in the plural,
mm-hmm.
were always a fuel for capitalism, whether it's our physical death, work to death, you know, or the death or the shattering of honor, you know, being raped. It wasn't just women or girls too, it's also men and boys. The accumulation from our lives and our deaths is just like clockwork.
Yeah.
The difference now, maybe most noticeably so, is that Black people can also accumulate more.
Mm-hmm.
It used to be, you know, like white people, you know, killed you, ran you from your land. Remember, we went from 20% of the farming land at the turn of the 20th century to now we have 1% Black farmers, right? Only way we lose that much land is they terrorized us off the land. So they accumulate through terror. But now you can see how you can accumulate through social movements. So if you can accumulate through social movements, and still not control the police or police violence, still not get the state to actually do something tangible, which means it would have to turn on some of its sectors because it's relied on white supremacist violence, like, you know, as an enforcer, right? This is why it's so painful and traumatic. I don't think individually we can claim anything. I think the only legitimate claims have to be collective. And we have to be disciplined to that. Does that mean you let the whole neighborhood move into your house? No, right? But it does mean that you're going to have to cede ground. And I'm directing this to the Black leadership that is publicly the Black leadership. There has to be an accountability metric where the mask, I mean, they're not going to ever control you because like we're never going to agree to that, right? But there has to be an accountability metric where they can check you, where they can publicly say that speech you just made or that, you know, campaign you just signed on to or shaming us to vote for this person, whatever, like, you know, you need to stand down. Because if you can't get our leadership to stand down, they will continue to accumulate. And by the nature of accumulation, they will be increasingly alienated from the Black mass.
Mm-hmm. Can you clarify what you mean by stand down? I'm just curious how you're defining that.
I'm glad you asked that. Okay, so I've said like another podcast, the reason I wrote Airbrushing was because I was talking to graduate students and they were being intimidated to look like reasonable radicals. And I was like, what's that? I don't know what that is. But, you know, like more like, you know, the academics we've been talking about, less, and they're not like George. I mean, look, if you're getting a doctorate, you're not George Jackson. Everybody knows that, right? But yeah. In Airbrushing, I was trying to gesture, and this is why I was being reticent. Like, I'm not here to, you know, bash people, whatever. But I do have a right to say what I believe to be ethical. And I think maybe airbrushing is a statement, like, because I'm still trying to figure out why I wrote it, how. I mean, obviously, I was pissed when I was writing it to some degree. But I was writing for people to stand down. Like when I say you show more peerage with, you know, wealthy conservatives and progressives than you do with the working class, that's like stand down. That you accumulate hundreds of thousands of millions of dollars that nobody even knows. Like how many houses do you need? You right?
Right.
Then, you know, stand down. If you keep saying I earn my money and you do car commercials and da da da, like stand down. Like nobody in this sector is poor. You have to have a limits on the accumulation. And if you can literally, as like, because the youth, as I say, they know, how do they know what people make? I don't know what they make, but they know how like individual Black faculty can make like 900K base salary. It's like, nah, nobody. And they're like, yes. And I was like, okay, well, however you want to accumulate, do not discipline the radicals. And that's what I mean by stand down. If you're going to make money, white people make money. Everybody's making, you know, it's capitalism. This is greed is like part of the, you know,
right,
the coda.
It kind of is what it is in that part. Yeah,
but it's not necessary for you to bash people who are more radical and who take more risk. If you're doing that, I just feel you're taking out a competitor. You're like, I'm trying to gentrify that neighborhood and you're like bringing it back down. Who do you like? No, we're like gentrifying.
Feel that way. You're right.
Yeah. And so look, if they were not disciplining, and again, I'm not an Afro-pessimist, but you know, some of them I know, and some of them were really radical, but they just don't organize anymore. But if you're bashing anything that looks like it could be more quote left than you, because you have to be the authentic Black left leadership, I mean, at least Condoleezza Rice on every other whatever day is honest.
Mm-hmm.
Right, if you're working for the Bush administration, you back Kavanaugh, you're telling me you're a reactionary. And even though that's not my preference, you're not pretending like you're leading us to freedom.
And nobody's really, most of us aren't following her anyway, right? Like she's not.
She's irrelevant.
Yeah.
Like Clarence Thomas. I mean, the best you can do is hurt us through law, but it's not even a joke. You don't even have real power because when they want an interchangeable Negro or Negress, they just will get another.
Right.
You know, a younger version or somebody who speaks like three languages or, you know, is from Latin American and Black. I mean, they can find Black.
Candace Owens type.
Yeah. Like there's like all these people lined up, like pay me and I'll say whatever you needs to be said, right?
I was going to say, to your point about using the language of war when, you know, concerning the state, correct me if I'm wrong, I don't think they even use the language of violence, at least not in the way that you talk about it in the mainstream.
Yeah, well, you can't, I mean, mm-hmm. like I've said in past, I grew up in a military mm-hmm. family mm-hmm. with an officer, and it took me a while to figure out what he was doing. But then, how do you get to be a Black officer mm-hmm. in the Imperial Army? You're probably doing some version of counterinsurgency, right?
Right. Mm-hmm.
And so I don't even have to pretend like I came out of a leftist family, because I did not, right? I don't have to pretend like I'm a secular communist, right? Because I was in seminary and I went to all these Catholic schools. Like I'm indoctrinated to be a reactionary, right? But then I reacted against the indoctrination. So I never was in the good graces of the left based on my origin story. There's nothing noble about my story. Right. It's just like, I survived, I'm still alive. That's like, it's a big deal, right?
Right.
For other people where these expectations, I don't want to say that are projected onto you, you're gonna be the next generation of leaders. You're gonna be, you mm-hmm. know, we're gonna teach you all this radicalism and socialism, communism, and then you're gonna teach the uneducated or undereducated.
Missionary type, yeah.
Yeah. So my mother, you know, when she was a child, she was a sharecropper in Mississippi. So sometimes in my podcast, you can hear I'm not doing subject-verb agreement, because my first like introduction to English wasn't standard. I don't even care anymore. But, you know, decades ago, I'd be like, oh my gosh, diction, lessons, I can't even say it. But it's sort of like, I don't care. But what I do care about are the gatekeepers. It's, you know, we can't discipline. Let me put it this way. If the suicide rates of our children are increasing, we can't even keep our kids alive, much less discipline them, like the way to fit in the mold. And the mm-hmm. mold only works for a certain percentage. So it's a competitive race,
mm.
right? It's not even it's a like minotaur's maze, right? So when academics start to accumulate this much power, because I've been in the industry for decades, I see it as a rigged game. Like I want us to remember George Jackson's mother, you know, in that interview that she gave after he was killed.
I think they expected me to go and sit in the corner and cry and not really look at George, but I did, I looked at him. I saw everything that happened to him. He was shot more than once. In fact, his body was mutilated. George was a fine-looking man, but you wouldn't have been able to recognize him after they got through with him. It seemed as if they just did things to him for a vengeance, you know. And then when I talked on the phone to him about it at San Quentin, they said everybody was glad he was dead. And you could tell that they were glad for what they did to his body.
She's like, the prison guards didn't even, you know, the administration didn't even call me. I found out on the radio, right? And then she said, they thought that I wouldn't want to see him, but I was like, this is the courage of the mother. Mamie Till Mobley, 1955. You mutilated Emmett, put him in the water. I get him back. Supposedly they packed lye in the coffin to accelerate. And she tells the mortician, the Black, you know, funeral director, don't change anything. Now he's horrified, so he's like, no, I gotta sew like the eyelid shut or something. But it's an open casket funeral. In a way, through language and love, Mrs. Jackson held an open casket funeral for George mm-hmm. by having a press conference to say, mm-hmm. I looked at him. They didn't think I would, but I did. And she's like, he was shot more than once. He was mutilated. He was a fine looking Black man. And they left, you know, look at this on the table, right? So that is when we have the courage to deal with the violent nature of our citizenship. Some people would call it captivity. But I think most of that is erased because I think people want to keep us upbeat and aspirational.
Black boy, black girl magic, all that stuff. Yeah.
Yeah. And I'm not, I'm black girl magic, black boy magic, black trans magic. I don't have a problem. But if there's a predator, you can't party when the predator is like roaming around. I mean, you can party sometimes, but you can't like, let's celebrate every dude. Like, wait, who's watching the windows and the doors? Like, nobody, like, I'm out. I'm not at this party anymore, right? Because there's no longevity here. Like, this party's going to be shot up.
Yeah. No, that's a that's explicit, but that's a great way of putting it, because that's often how it comes off. Again, it goes back to the point about war, though. It's if you can only do that if you don't acknowledge there's a war,
right?
There's no predator. Like, that's the way it gets sold back. It's the predator is abstract at best if you acknowledge abstract. It. You know,
it's us
somewhat, right? Contained or something.
Yeah, but the predator becomes us. Mm. So then, I appreciate the therapeutic modalities, but they're like, we need to lower our aggression, which is totally true. We need to reduce harm to each other, which is totally true. We need to have like reconnection, reconciliation, totally true. I totally agree. Now, if you use that same language with the state that has no emotional intelligence,
right?
It doesn't cry. Like, look at, no, think about it, right? Because I'm coming from military.
Mm-hmm.
How many people suicide every day coming back from those wars that never end?
Mm-hmm.
They don't care if they're white men. I mean, like, yeah. Literally, if Attica, if they shot through white guards to kill black rebels, they don't have a problem, like, expendable white people.
Yeah. It's like you're trying to empathize with a psychopath.
Yeah, I mean, you get to say that. I don't, right? Because I still have to avoid. But that's okay. I could say, that's an interesting formulation. Yeah, so if it's not a life-giving, but it's a life-taking, and that it used consumerism to fill the void, then yeah, this is mentally disordered. This is pathological. The parental state is pathological. If you keep people inside when there's a pandemic, knowing that they're more likely to get COVID, and these are low level or they're not going to be a threat, but you just want to show I can keep you inside and you can get COVID and I'm not going to lose my day job. That is pathology. If you can, like, you know, you talked about W.L. Nolan, if I remember the legal petition that he got killed for, it literally one of the items is stop putting broken glass in human feces in our food.
Mm-hmm.
That's pathology. If you have a guard, like, what are you doing to your day? Oh, I'm going to the bathroom. Well, like, what is this, right? And now you're in the kitchen? No, uh-uh. But they get away with it. So it's the physical violence, of course, but like if we actually sit and reflect on like last 500 years, unless you have something that grounds you that's more than rhetoric or aspiration, you're likely going to retreat. Because nobody wants to go to war, including people who are already in a war. Like, do you remember the Boots Riley and the coup? They did guillotine. Mm-hmm. And the sister that transitioned, I can't remember her name, but she's dressed up as Dorothy from Oz, right? And one of the lines that she's singing is, we were in a war before we fought one.
Mm.
Like, you know, George was made a warrior because he was in a war zone. But before he was like, Nolan, let's try the legal route and see if we can get out and follow the rules and do the petitions. But if law betrays you, you follow the law and it kills you, you disobey the law and it kills you, then you're dealing with pathology.
Yeah, and I think that's the part when you were saying they're not crazy. I think that speaks to that part, right? Because they went through the process. I think the myth with radical or even revolutionaries is that you just woke up almost in a way pathologically just angry about shit. Excuse my French, as opposed to being as opposed to going through a process like George and them did. I mean, when you read the earlier letters in Soledad Brothers, you can watch
him go through his own process. And then, like you said, with W.L. Nolan, this is someone who's trying to administer some type of justice through the court system, through the quote unquote justice system, even as he's in prison. Mm-hmm. And this is the response is to kill them off. Yeah, I mean, you know, so by the time, you know, Jonathan is watching this happen, his brother's already there on $70, you know, that he may not even stole that, but he's there on $70 and then he's watching that happen. So for him, it was just a logical conclusion to do what he did. And we look at it like it's crazy, right. But that process makes sense. But prison has a different effect on you. It's a dead city. There isn't anything to, there is no consumerism to get caught up in the same way. There's not as many things to distract you. I'm not saying everybody in prison is a revolutionary, but I'm just saying the reality of where you're at is very clear to you. There's not many, as many things that can distract you from that, whether you choose to retreat or not. I think with George Jackson, it was clear. And I think that's, I don't know, I guess the question would be like, there's no clear answers here, but like, how do we, if there is a way to combat that way that reality becomes mystified, because George Jackson talks about, we went through this process, we've already seen electoral politics don't work, we've already seen these things don't work, but right. We still keep trying these things, even though the record is fairly clear. Like, what do you do with that?
Yeah, I don't know what we do with that. I think collectively, I mean, that's a great question. I think we have to move forward and share our different narratives on how we cope. I mean, how do you do this podcast that has all this, and I mean, you're not like talking about recipes for carrot cake, which I love carrot cake, right? So I'd be happy if you did that too. But it's like, you're not dealing with the mundane, you're dealing with the terrifying. And so you give the history, you do give the analysis. I mean, it's really structured. But if you look down that corridor, you see where you're going, right? You're like, well, I'm just bringing you up to like the facts and the data and the analysis. This is educational. But again, if you just look down the corridor, it's like, wow, I kind of see where we're going here. But part of the reality is, look, we were always there. We were always there. I mean, if it's just somebody random who's not even politicized in the conventional way in which we're talking about politics, George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, like think of it, the people we're talking about in this era, like that became high spectacle assassinations by the state, were rebel militants. The people in this century that are high profile, you know, victims of state police violence, murder, they're civilians. Mm-hmm. There's no record of organizing as far as I know, and it's not saying that they have to have been organizing or activists, but we've gone from, how to say it, the hunt through COINTELPRO was lethal, but it did have a little bit of precision, or maybe more than a little bit, right? Because it was a military endeavor. It was neutralized, mop up. Mm-hmm. There will be no Black freedom that's going to alter the trajectory of capitalism, imperial. I mean, like, it was what the Panthers at their best. UEB, you know, had a lot of trauma and then started traumatizing a lot of the people later. But at our best, what we were seeking was to rebirth the world. There was no way for us to be free unless the entire world changed. Mm-hmm. So that's when you get like 8,000 people coming to George Jackson's funeral. And there's a lot of white people. I mean, it's the diversity, because they were people who want to change the world. And I think if I recall, like Hoover's, wasn't, you know, paranoia, oppressions, right? You could see the future. Like Black rebels were resonating across the globe. But this is in part, I think, why Davis wanted to be aligned with them. She could have decided to go to a university in the South, or she could have decided not to take UCLA, but to go teach philosophy at an HBCU. She didn't have to be open about being a member of the Communist Party. If I recall, Dorothy Healy, who is a white mentor, said, no, don't say anything, and they can't prove anything.
Yeah, she says in the autobiography, she said even the Regents Board was surprised that she even said it. They thought she was just going to plead the fifth. That was the process that most communists went through back then. They just pled the fifth, and she was like, no, I'm a communist. I just wanted to add that point.
It's an important point. Yeah. So Davis has courage. But again, that's how you lose a job. That is not necessarily a terror zone, mm-hmm. which is what the prison, which the maximum security, like lose a job, lose your life. Two different things. And like, yes, they're adjacent. So Davis is going to go underground. But as I said before, it was a different kind of underground. David Poindexter didn't have to be, again, I listened to your podcast. He didn't have to be, I agree with you. People are labeling people. I'm not trying to do that. I'm saying it's very complicated, right? Mm-hmm. And so when we get our revolutionary history put down on the table in front of us or in a book or in a film, we understand that there are going to be embedded contradictions.
Right.
But Poindexter's father was a Black communist and his mother was a white wealthy woman. And so Davis is underground and it ends in New York City, right? Which is one of the headquarters of the Communist Party. And it starts really in Chicago, which is another stronghold or headquarter of the Communist Party. So Davis's underground is likely structured by the Communist Party. Whereas the Panthers underground is structured, I mean, for the people who go into the Black Liberation Army, it's structured, right, by COINTELPRO hunt.
Mm-hmm.
See, and so I'm not saying Davis wasn't at risk. Davis was at risk, but they weren't hunting Davis because they were a leader of a Black rebellion. There's no communique when Davis is underground. There's no organizing when Davis is underground. The underground is around the individual, not the collective or the cadre. There's no cell.
Yeah, they weren't in cells, She wasn't in a cell.
Like there's no political function other than staying alive long enough. And then people are mounting the defense and then, you know, the Life magazine cover. And then people are just mesmerized because they've never seen this before. George, George Jackson endures, not just because he was a martyr. He was so brilliant. But he was self-trained. I mean, literally, you go in at 17, he had 99 books in his cell. So Freedom Archives has sent out the 99 books, which is a list. George had a library in his cell. When they went to collect his things after he was murdered, there was a library, like everybody, you know, worth reading that George could get a handle on. They were there. Davis is an intellectual too, but they're not comparable, right? Because George is forced to think in terror zones. Mm. And so his thinking becomes transcendent, scary, totally. And then when you get to Blood in My Eye, really frightening, right?
Yeah.
But he's thinking without boundaries. Davis is thinking within the disciplined parameters of the Communist Party, Toni Morrison as editor, Charlene Mitchell as mentor in the Che Lumumba Club, right? And think of the Che Lumumba Club, and I've said this before, if you have, as a Communist Party, to build a club named after martyred guerrilla fighters, and that's what Lumumba was, right? And that's what Guevara was. Then you're kind of messaging that you're relevant. People who are organic on the ground don't have to name themselves. Like the Black Panther Party was like, we're Black, got the Panther, as you point out, from Lowndes County, probably, but that's all Black formation. We don't have to take the names of slain martyrs to show that we're in the fight. We live in the neighborhood.
Right. Right. It's already there.
It's already there.
Yeah.
There's no filter for George. And so when you read him, I mean, what he gives you is pretty much everything he has without reticence, without caution. Because he doesn't figure out that he's going to live long. I mean, if Jonathan could have pulled it off, you know, maybe George would have gone to Cuba and then they would have sent him to Angola because he's a fighter. It's like, you can't stay here. We're stabilizing the country. Why don't you go to Angola and see what you can do over there with him, right? But it's like, That's why revolution, I think people mystify war because maybe they don't want to engage with revolutionary thought or struggle. I the violence is everywhere. It's in our culture, it's in our movies, it's in the songs, it's in the porn, you know, it's every, I mean, this is such a violent.
Yeah, country. It's saturated, oversaturated. Yeah. So
what becomes really scary then is not the violence because it's just quote normative. It's the political violence that seeks to counter the state. That is what freaks everybody out. Violence by itself is not destabilizing because the nation is built on violence. Mass rape, mass enslavement, genocide. I mean, you build a democracy on genocide, what do you get? I mean, you can think shot through with violence.
Yeah.
But once you think, okay, now we know who you are, what are our alternatives? And they could be pacifists. I'm not saying that you have to be a militarist. King was a pacifist. But once you face that and you start to like, okay, where are the crevices, the cracks? How do you take this apart? How do we build communities? How do we take ourselves out of a predatory economy? How do we organize? I mean, that's where the wild cards show up. So I would say that George Jackson was a wild card, but Davis was not. The situation that was built around Davis was uniquely, you know, different from anything we'd ever seen before. But that was, a lot of people helped build that as a phenomenon.
Another quote I'm gonna read, then I had a question. I have a lot of questions, but we talked about David's study, Mark Hughes, and there was a quote that he did have. He says, to what you were saying about the wild card factor. He says the strains and stresses suffered by the individual in society are grounded in the normal functioning of that society and the individual rather than its disturbances and its diseases. So in a way, it's to say that, you know, the stuff that, like you said, the violence is so normalized, and that's suffering is just seen as every day. When someone actually strikes out, to your point, or doesn't follow that order, then there's something wrong with them, right? That they're the pathological one, they're the crazy person, whatever, right? So I would just go ahead.
But it's like the children you put in these schools and you teach them to sit and conform and obey, and they're like just so bored, right? Because it's painful. Yeah. I mean, boredom is a form of pain. But the ones, you know, that, you know, I've heard some of the testimonies from Black Panthers, you know, one who like left school at 12. And of course, you know, that's the parents' quote worst nightmare. You know, because the whole thing about protecting the child is to control the Black child. And you figure that's how you get longevity. If I can get you to lower your voice, say, you don't have to say yes, sir, no, ma'am all the time, but just like, you know, color within the lines, right? And you get a free child. It's like, what the, you know, like, how do we keep this kid alive, you know? And so, you know, I think we've gotten used to the brutality because it's came in small dosages for the petty bourgeoisie, you know, because we could feed our kids or we could feed our elders or get them insulin or whatever. But for people who are in zones of captivity, which are just like, you know, war zones, prisons, the precarity is so blatant. There's no fluff. There's nothing, there's no cushion. And so the wild card with Marcuse, I mean, he's learning from Davis. Like first he meets her at Brandeis. She's a French major. She switches over to philosophy after, you know, I think an independent study with him or hearing him give a lecture or something.
Yeah, she said in the book, I'm just remembering the book again. Okay. She said, he asked her why she wanted to do philosophy and she didn't even have she said she didn't even know if she had a good answer. And he told her to read a few like pre-Greek philosophers and come back to her or something like that. Mm-hmm. Come back to him and then she went from there.
So he awakens the imagination, but he also says she was completely apolitical. And in mm-hmm. undergraduate years, you know, Germany, she's talking to Algerians, but you know, I mean, I don't know if y'all have gone abroad as Black Americans, right?
Yeah, I've experienced that. Yeah.
Yeah, so, you know, a friend of mine who's a Panther, you know, he would be harassed, you know, but in France, right? But he just like flips that eagle up and they back down, right? The local cops.
Remember the story kind of inverted, but remember the story Angela tells about when they start speaking in French in America, and how the white shop owner let her sit at the front, her and her sister.
Yeah.
So,
but this is all the elite of the internationalist class. Mm-hmm. Like, if you're speaking French, you're not a local sharecropper, even local Black bourgeoisie, then you must be from Morocco, or you're some, you know, that your parents just brought you to the US to shop, right? And so again, you could be a Black militant Panther and you're like in Paris or something with your mom, who's not a militant Panther, and you're gonna be harassed as a teenager, and you know to flip the eagle, like, you know, show the passport. And they're like, well, unless the US told us we can take them, we can't really take them right now, right? So it's just sort of, we can't really cash in on the perks, but we know how to manipulate and leverage them, right? But the wild card for Mercuza, it can't be Davis, because she's disciplined by the Communist Party. And the Communist Party, the Soviets, right? They hate Mercuza.
Yeah.
Because he's critiquing them. And they're like, you know, I don't know what kind of names they talk about in improv already, but they're like skewering him because he's talking about freedom outside of party structure. He's not looking for any kind of authoritarian formation or vanguard.
Vanguard, yeah.
So the Communist Party is a vanguard formation. So when Davis decides to join, she understands the function of hierarchy because she's joining an incredibly hierarchical institution, and she will be on its central committee. That means when they give orders, you follow. And having grown up in the military, I mean, I get a sense of that. Of course, they were doing it for the progressives, and where I was growing up, they were, you know, mostly reactionaries. So structure is embedded in Davis. There is no structure for George or the rebels. They are outside structure. Mm-hmm. And that is where they're vulnerable. But that's also where they're transformational, because they're not relying on structure, taking their cues from structure in terms of what do you do next with the empire. They're using experiential knowledge from organizing in the zone and trying to stay alive. And some organize as long as they can. Some are killed. Some go to prison. Some do their time and come out. Some just drop out of the party and become academics, or, you know, and people have trauma, whatever, how they're dealing it. But if I look at Davis, I see structure everywhere. There is no point when there was no structure.
Yeah.
Like, even when they were gonna fire them at UCLA, the faculty were gonna like raise money and still pay Davis's salary in defiance of the regents. So they have the backing of the white academics on UCLA because they're the ones that hired him. However they felt about Davis associating with Panthers or whatnot, they understood, we hired her, she belongs to us. Mm-hmm. And it's not like chattel slavery ownership, but it's Derrick Bell, that affinity to powerful, influential white people, because this is the way I see it. I could be totally wrong. If powerful white people say they want something, you should kind of let them, you should just let them, you know, if they're like, that's my, you know, LGBTQ person, or that's my Roma person, or that's my undocumented person, I want the babies out of the cages, I want X, Y, and Z. The democracy responds to that, not really in a lethal way. You know, it's kind of like Joe Biden, like, what can we, well, maybe we'll let certain kids go, but we're going to deport the Haitians, right? I mean, we'll just sort of like, we'll figure out a way to meet your needs, your emotional needs, or your needs to be ethical or whatever, but we're not going to give freedom and agency to these groups, right? And so I'm going back to the academy. When we work for predominantly white institutions that are research one or Ivy League institution, that means we belong to a certain degree and we are embedded in structure. So to even have the capacity to think like a revolutionary, that's gonna be very difficult. Marcuse was alone. I mean, he got death threats too. I'm betting that Angela first, you know, decided the whole gun weapon thing. Of course she grew up with it in Alabama with her dad, you know, protecting in the other, I guess it's mostly fathers protecting the neighborhood. But Marcuse's white students were bringing guns to campus and sitting outside the lecture hall to deter white supremacists, you know, anti-communists from killing Marcuse. So at UC San Diego, which is where those military bases are and like the Minutemen, you had the you know, if Davis was just watching what, you know, she hits campus and she's just watching what's going on, there are cadres of white armed students who are like, we're keeping Marcuse alive. So by the time you go to UCLA, that's reproduced. It's not just the campus guard, but like probably Panthers and other, definitely Jonathan too, right? As you noted, we're keeping Davis alive, Angela Davis alive. That's our job. That's what we do. But I would just say, just, you know, to wrap this part up, those are foot soldiers. And foot soldiers are expendable in war. And sometimes, right? Because you want the elite, you want what shines. Like whatever Mick Jagger is going to write a song for. He's not writing a song for, you know, Jonathan Jackson, right? So right. You want something that makes you feel transcendent above the crowd. And so I think a lot of that romantic projections that go out that want to deflect from how violent the state is, I think it's probably based on emotional need to see ourselves elevated above the fray.
And I want to stay there, but then there's some other things you said within your statement about the communists, and we had talked about this a little bit, the Communist Party relationship to, you know, that is still a lot of your elite European white people that are, you know, that are involved in this party. And I actually had talked to Jared from, you know, Millennials of Killing Capitalism. We were just conversing the last few days about that particular point in relationship to how the CPS USA was, it was multiracial, but we know historically it started to do the whole, you know, popular front. This is a lot of what Jared was saying, and it supported more liberalism. And then that's how you kind of end up with the Gloria Steinem relationship, who worked with the CIA. And then you also have around the world, the whole non-alignment movement. Countries who are choosing to not align themselves with people who don't know, who basically just liberation movements who are choosing to not align themselves with either Soviet Russia or the United States. They're going to make their own path, whether they choose their version of communism or socialism or capitalism is neither here nor there in this particular case. So I guess how, and this might be a little bit outside of the scope of the conversation, but how are we supposed to think about that as well? Just this, how, you know, we talk about the socialism and we obviously, most of us, especially on podcasts like this, don't mess with capitalism, but what do you do when the whiteness is still showing up in the way that it does with the Communist Party or a lot of these white leftist organizations even today? Like, how do you navigate that? And I know, again, that might be a little outside of the scope, so you don't have to speak long on it.
I think it's relevant. I mean, okay, white revolutionaries exist. I mean, I think Bo Brown, who is, I think, a transgender activist, they formed the George Jackson Brigade or something after George was killed. Now, I wouldn't have done what they did. You know, it was definitely, you're going to do time for what you were doing. But if I say 8,000 people came to his funeral, I don't think they were gawkers or spectators. I think they came to one, and there were white people there. So you have white revolutionaries, you have white rebels. Even when Cornel West said that Antifa kept him alive at Charlottesville a couple years ago, and Heather Heyer was murdered by the, what are those people's called? I don't even care what they call, alt-right, whatever they were.
The guys with the tiki torches and all of that. You're right.
It's this, you know, John Brown, like W.B. Du Bois says that his favorite book was the biography on John Brown, but the white editor kept making him like tone it down. But if Du Bois liked John Brown, and you know how John Brown went out, then you know, there are aspects to it. There are also black men who were with John Brown as well. They didn't get, you know, the honor of burials. Their bodies were, you know, donated to medical labs for dissection, or people took, you know, body parts home like a lynching. But I think increasingly of the maroon camps, you know, like when I talk about the stages of the captive maternal, I'm just mm-hmm. maroon. And the maroon camp can have all kinds of allies and solidarity. Marcuse was if Angela Davis had a maroon camp, intellectual, right? But also like physical. The maroon camp included Marcuse to a point. And then I would say, you know, once you're embedded in the Communist Party and they're getting their support from the Soviet Union and the Soviet Union hates Marcuse, he's not going to be your advisor for whatever reasons. That might contribute. So right. She's later going to get her dissertation like at Humboldt University in Germany, and Marcuse fades away, right? But right.
And you don't hear about him anymore in the book either. after a certain point, he's literally not in the.
Yeah, but I mean, people are disposable. Do you notice? Like, this is the thing about structure. And again, we need structure, but it's to the extent that we're disciplined, we lose narratives. It's like film footage or whatever you lose on the cutting floor, on the cutting room floor, because it's contradicting the dominant narrative that has to have a nice wrap. Like, you know, I mean, the way that autobiography is written, like there's the beginning and the middle and the end, and you know, there's an upbeat end, right? But there's not much of a warning that, okay, y'all need to be aware that decades from now, they may try to sell you your own movement back.
Right.
And it might be mush or toxic waste, but you won't know it because it's painted really pretty and has a big afro and hoop earrings or whatever, you know, or tattoos, and it's like chic and it's like edgy and it's black. So it's marketable. I mean, this is 500 years. You can sell anything if it's associated with us, including us. So, the Communist Party, I mean, I've said before, like I was asked to join, I said no, and I misunderstood the relationship. Like I thought we can just organize together in solidarity. It's like, no, but now I better understand because it's a discipline formation. Once you're inside, you follow the rules. If you're outside, you can go rogue. Even if it's for a good cause, it's not authorized. So there's a highly, there's a controlled aspect to it that, you know, freedom seekers who need to be free while they're seeking it aren't going to be compatible. So again, that's why you have to brand a Che Lumumba club to attract people. And that club never really takes off other than Angela and a few other people, which are really Charlene Mitchell, her two brothers, and you know, Franklin's wife,
Franklin. Yeah.
And then a younger brother. They had a younger brother. So it's really a small family group, right? At this time. So I don't think we should go through life distrusting everybody, but I think we should go through life trying to trust ourselves more and our intuitive knowledge, our emotional intelligence. And understand that we really can grapple with the tragedies that we've inherited, because inside those tragedies and traumas, there's a coda, there's a script, there are analyses that we can use to push things forward so our children are less terrorized. And our elders, you know, as you get older, you're going to care for your parents and, you know, try to help them find dignity while they transition. Like, we shouldn't have multiple layers of trauma impeding our abilities, not just to be free, but to live and thrive to some degree. But I think also we would have to agree that celebrity leadership is done.
Yeah.
No more celebrity. We're done. We're here. Yeah. Like, I mean, maybe I'll go to the movie. Maybe I won't when it comes out, like the biopics. But you, once you go down that road and you start marketing yourself, and marketing our freedom struggles as an extension of yourself, right? That's a dead end road. Or it's circular. You just come right back into the Pentagon. Or, you know, Deutsche Bank, or, you know, you're just back on Wall Street again. Because it's all about capital. And I don't want to, you know, I don't want us to start hating on each other any more than we're already doing it. But I think to come to terms with our grief and our loss, which means to come to terms with reality, we have to agree that all our heroes were not crazy mm-hmm. and all our celebrated heroes were not inherently heroic for the mass. Sometimes you're just caught between a rock and a hard place and you just have to do stuff to survive, and then the way people tell the story later. But you know, if Chris Hani, as I said before, is assassinated, but Nelson Mandela is the mentor, then I can't really ride with you, you know, other than down the block, because we're not going anywhere, right?
Right.
And also to your point about, you know, not looking around the corner, you're already in the midst of the issue, very in the midst of the violence and the war right now. I think that was pretty interesting. Maybe if we can use that framework and to actually just, I guess, teach other people.
Yeah.
But go ahead.
Do you think maybe it's just time that we acknowledge how vulnerable we are?
Yeah.
Not just physically, but emotionally, psychologically. Like, just stop pretending.
Mm-hmm.
Like, we got this. Because so much, I think, of the politics that are performative are pretending that, like, I've got this. If you just do A, B, and C, we're going to get 1, 2, and 3. And maybe not in your lifetime, but the next. It's like my great, 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 great. No, I mean, the planet will be burnt like a toast maybe by then. But I think if we're just clear that we're raw, mm-hmm. if George Jackson, this is Black August, right? George and Jonathan were raw. But, you know, I wouldn't necessarily want to live in the same communal home with them or some shit, because people always be like coming for them and, you know, stray bullets on you. But I have to tell you, because they existed, another dimension of me can exist, even if it's only on the level of what if. What if they had survived? What if they had made it to Cuba? What if an international movement had been able to, like, contained imperialism? What if, you know, just multiple what ifs, instead of like binge watching Netflix or some like distraction from the pain, just like face it with, like, what if we flipped it? What if our children live to old age? What if no mother or father ever has to look at their child in a coffin as a mutilated being that doesn't even look like they have features anymore? So that, you know, that's how I wanted to start with the what if. I don't want abstract freedom dreams, because we know too much. And I think it's dishonest based on who we are. I think we can handle it. I don't know what we will mutate into, but we're not gonna mutate into crazy people. We're not gonna mutate into pathology. We're gonna mutate. I've been talking about, I don't even know what it means, but I've been talking about revolutionary love. We're gonna mutate into a highly disciplined cadre that follows revolutionary love wherever it takes you. And again, it doesn't have to be militarist, but don't allow people to sell you simulacra.
Right, right. I was going to ask you about Attica in relation to pragmatism, but it's kind of interesting that we're at this particular point, because what seems to be, for lack of a better word, one of the craziest things is how a lot of the stuff we've been discussing, the capitulating to capital that people tell us is basically more pragmatic, it's more practical. And then but also at the same time, we're sitting here talking about how Not even just for the Black poor, but even how crazy this makes even like the Black bourgeoisie, because the discipline and the structure of it forces you to lose yourself in many ways. So what about that is really pragmatic? And my original question was, how does Attica, partly inspired by George Jackson, complicate our idea of what's pragmatic in the face of war? Because, you know, they did write petitions and things of that nature. They didn't just take over the prison on day one, right? But I guess this idea of pragmatism, I question how pragmatic are the things we've really been trying that our leaders tell us we should do. I don't know. I know we can say it keeps us alive, but at the cost of what, you know?
But, you know, I mean, one, we're all mortal, so we're going to die anyway.
Right.
But I don't think we should go prematurely or violently, right? Or, you know, starving or can't get medicine, you know, when you have pandemics or medical treatment when you need it. So, and I don't think we should suicide or we should OD either, or be snuffed out in prison or be turned into a sex slave. So it's like just some basic stuff here. There's nothing pragmatic about all those things that I just like ticked like a laundry list, but they're embedded in this culture. This is not a pragmatic culture. What you're talking about is a hustle.
Yeah.
You can call it a pragmatic hustle. I don't care. You're hustling in a predatory zone. That means like people do tricks, all kinds of tricks, you know, card tricks, other kind of trick, in order to set, like, what's pragmatic about that? What is pragmatic about burying your murdered child? There's nothing practical. Like, you can't tax us. Okay. I'm serious. I mean, they do. And if you don't, they'll take your house and your car. But I'm like, why the hell do we pay taxes? Right. Because I'm literally paying for police forces to kill people. Then I'm paying for the compensation packet after they kill you. You know, $1.8 million for Fred Hampton, Mark Clark, $27 million for Breonna Taylor's family. Mm-hmm. You know, so many million for Tamir Rice's family, et cetera, et cetera. Like, as I said, often enough, and again, just let me pay for pre-K. I don't mind giving my money to the collective, but this is not practical or pragmatic. This is predatory. So don't confuse the predatory with the pragmatic.
Mm.
Because if it's a hustle around the predator so you can live long and have like multiple homes and a lot of cars, or just put food on the table, I totally understand. Like, you know, stage one of the captive maternal. Conflicting, right. Contradictory, you're gonna do all kind of, you know, like, oh my God, this is foul, but I'm gonna do it because my kid needs to stay in the school, or I need to keep this job, or et cetera, right? And then two, the protest that you say, you know, the Attica, like over human, however you want to define that, the movement, the maroon camp inside the prison, the next stage, and then the declaration of war from the state, because any attempt to be free, if you're Black, right, captive, is seen as war. So I want to go back to what you said there. This is pathology. I mean, we can find other P words before besides pragmatic. If the accumulation, right, if accumulation keeps skewing towards the top, and you used to have a lot of millionaires, and now you have billionaires, like becoming the norm, in terms of the ruling caste, Biden is better than Trump. But you tell that to a woman who was in one of those ICE camps, a Haitian sister who met the womb collector who gave her a forced hysterectomy. Mm. She will never have children. Her man leaves her because he wants children. I mean, like, nah, there's nothing pragmatic about consistently breaking people and humiliating them. So this Black pastor who said, after George Floyd was murdered, if you kill us, we'll kill your economy. I mean, that was over a year ago. I was listening to WBAI, and that keeps radiating. Like, okay, it doesn't even have to be kill. How about I'll neutralize your economy? But like, how is it that we could make people understand there will be a cost? And I'm not saying that we have to do it the way George did it. Jonathan was doing something different. That was really a liberation, you know, probably like, you're going to want your judge to stay alive, as you pointed out in your important podcast. You're going to want the assistant district attorney to stay alive. There's two women jurors up in this here, you know, van. You're not going to kill your own people. And they're like, yeah. I mean, that was the same Attica. Like, don't misread the state. It's notion of practicality. It's just a utilitarian function for its predatory behavior. And so the point is not to be pragmatic. The point is, how do you deal with a predator?
Mm.
On all levels. Like, you wouldn't let the predator roam through, you know, kindergarten with your kids in it. So why do you let the predator roam through your community?
Now that's a word. The point is not to be pragmatic. The point is how to deal with the predator. Yeah, is there a pragmatic way to deal with the predator? You know, like, yeah. It's just,
we're gonna be practical. Okay, here's the deal. This is my understanding of us as a people. If we were pragmatic, we'd probably all be dead, or most of us be dead, right? if we were pragmatic, we would never have a rebellion.
Right.
If we were pragmatic, I mean, you could say, well, pragmatics, 200,000 of us fight in the Civil War, but we were fighting before then, and then they reneged on us. I mean, the only reason this looks somewhat like a democracy is because we were never pragmatic.
Right.
We made demands when they said they would kill us, and not just kill us, kill our entire families, and sometimes they did that, right? Lynching is always a collective phenomenon. So if we were pragmatic, we wouldn't have any civil rights. So I'm saying, like, just keep it real. You know, you think the practical is what got us this far? No, it's the imaginative, it's the risk-taking, it's the culture. Let's go back to Birmingham. People, the murder, the bombs, But also what happened, my understanding, which nobody talks about, and I don't think Davis talks about it either, is a sector of the Black community that wasn't pragmatic decided to burn down part of Birmingham.
You never hear that.
No, you never hear that because you're focused on the trauma. Mm. And since you focus on the trauma and the loss, you forget our agency. And I'm not saying we could have done a prayer circle rather than just put gasoline on stuff in downtown businesses and start fires. And of course, more people died from that, right? Black people. Because white people came out to shoot you and sheriffs were out there to shoot you, whatnot. But the expression of their rebellion, you don't tell me the city kind of got a clue. Like, if we keep doing this, we're going to lose most of this. They're going to burn down the entire city.
Right.
Like, how would they regroup later when they see the resistance? There's a pause. They're stunned because they thought we were broken and there would be no resistance. Now, do they come back even more lethal? Yeah, probably. But we still keep resisting. So this is a way I want to end thinking about this. If you're going to use the term pragmatic to discipline radicals, my preference is that you say nothing.
Mm.
You know, if you want to discipline Biden and Harris, you can throw pragmatic at them all day, all night. I don't care. If you're going to discipline rebels with that, then you need to pony up something tangible, like I will raise bail funds with you, pay for your attorney, feed your kids while you're inside, you know, try to get you out. You can't just lecture people about being, quote, infantile in their politics out of your fear or out of your accumulation.
Mm.
There's nobody we admire who's pragmatic. Malcolm, I've said this before, Malcolm could have kept the money or taken it. He didn't, stayed alive. Martin could have just gotten a little quiet church somewhere. And everybody could have been, quote, pragmatic. But if they were, we would not have any ancestors. Mm. What does it mean to be a people with no ancestors?
Mm.
You don't exist. Nobody loved you enough to do something impractical so that you wouldn't have to walk through a killing field.
Mm.
And I would rather take the love than the pragmatism.
Yeah, rarely am I at a loss for words. Thank you everybody for listening. Thank you, Dr. James, for coming in. And I know, you know, there's consequences to speaking truth to power. So we you know, appreciate you not being pragmatic as well.
Well, I want to say, because y'all are much younger and reassuring isn't the right verb. But, you know, if I did anything useful, trust that I send you my gratitude and admiration from the other side.
Thank you.
Take care, y'all.
Thank you.
Okay. Fresh out the plane in a whole nother state. I'm trying to eat down a whole nother plate. Seem like my homies were stuck.